Well, it follows from our exchange of emails that I would like to talk about the principles on climate obligations of enterprises. They are a follow-up of the Oslo principles and the group that was active in drafting these principles are Justice Brian Preston, a retired judge of the European Court of Human Rights, Elisabeth Steiner, and Professors Chin Chambao, Wuhan University, Jim Silk and Thomas Poshi, Yale, Philip Sutherland, South Africa, Stellenbosch, myself as reporter and author of the commentary, and my associate reporter Daniel Witte. And why did we start working on the Oslo and the enterprise principles? Well, in our view, there is a gap in the debate. The debate is often very useful, but also rather abstract. And very few people seem to care about concrete obligations of the major players, states, enterprises, and investors. And the Oslo principles tried to discern the legal obligations of states. We unfortunately could not reach agreement on the obligations of enterprises, and that's why a partly new, partly old group started working on that in much more detail than we had in mind when we were drafting the Oslo principles. The enterprises principles are, in the meantime, endorsed by many distinguished lawyers, among them justices from Supreme Courts from all continents, and one of them is your former Supreme Court Justice Hilario Davide. The principles are about what in our view is by far the most important, i.e. how can we keep global warming below 2 degrees. They are not about compensation. That's perhaps an important topic, but we simply don't address that topic. Mitigation is, in our view, by far the most important and challenging topic. And it is increasingly important to do so, and that's also why your commission does such an important job. I can't judge the merits of that kind of research. I'm a lawyer and I'm not a climate change scientist, but you know that according to recent research, we have to reckon perhaps with sea level rise at the rate of 58 meters, not in our lifetime, but still. We have to reckon with Category 6 hurricanes. And latest news, the oceans are soaking up more heat than estimated. And that means that emissions must be reduced with 25% more than previously estimated. Well, your commission understandably asked me specifically to talk about human rights law. I fully understand that. You are the Human Rights Commission. Our group believes that it would even be better to focus on as many legal sources as possible. That means international law, although that is not directly applicable to enterprises, also environmental law, tort stroke liability law, a series of codes of conduct, governance, guidelines, listing requirements, and also case law and academic writings. And as to human rights law, you are probably aware of a very recent judgment issued by the Court of Appeal of The Hague in the Urgenda case. And the court upheld an earlier judgment that the state is required to reduce its emissions by 25%. Unlike the court of first instance, the Court of Appeal largely bases the judgment on human rights. First, Article 2 of the European Convention on Human Rights, the Right to Life, and secondly, Family Life, Article 8. My colleagues and I know, of course, that there is a debate on the question whether human rights are of much avail in relation to enterprises. We believe human rights law is important also in relation to enterprises, be it with some caveats. First, we realize, of course, that not all regions have specific human rights legislation or conventions. But according to the prevailing view, human rights law vests obligations on states. But that's not to say that they are irrelevant in relation to enterprises. We believe they still are. Why? Well, at the very least, human rights law can and could and should, in our view, color domestic law and the interpretation of domestic law. And secondly, an increasing number of codes of governance and guidelines and other sources promote the idea that enterprises have to comply with human rights law. And that is often endorsed by many enterprises. Well, if that is the case, they can't be surprised that others draw the conclusion, well, apparently enterprises have to comply. Well, that's what they're also saying themselves. For more details, I refer to the commentary, and at the end of my presentation, I will present you a copy, hard copy, of both the Oslo principles and the enterprises principles. Environmental law also plays an important role. Why? Well, there are interesting developments. For example, the Global Pact for the Environment, issued by a group chaired by Laurent Fabius, and the Declaration on Environmental Rule of Law, issued by many very senior judges. And they clearly link environmental law with climate change. Well, that means that it matters, and it also seems to follow from these documents and other documents that they also believe that enterprises have obligations in the face of climate change. Our principles are based on our group's interpretation of the law. Of course, they are not law. They are our interpretation. We may be mistaken. But the fact that so many distinguished lawyers have endorsed our principles says at least that we did not a terribly bad job. But again, we may be mistaken. And we did not only look at as many sources as possible of the law, we also looked at our estimate of how the law will likely develop. Why? Well, how does the law work? You know that. At some stage, litigation will start, and then, after a couple of years, courts will issue judgments. And for practical purposes, on paper it's perhaps not true, but for practical purposes, those ideas will be applied with retroactive effect. Hence, it makes sense to take into account how the law will likely develop. Well, then, as to the concrete obligations. And then I have to start with the Oslo principles. Now, in a minute, I will explain why. The Oslo principles are saying that we first have to discern the carbon budget of a specific year based on the precautionary principle and on the idea that global warming has to be kept below 2 degrees. I'll come back to that at the final part of my presentation. The resulting figure has to be divided by the number of people living on our planet. Hence, we have the permissible quantum per person. If you multiply that with the number of inhabitants of a specific country, you have the figure that is the acceptable level of emissions of that country. Some countries, mostly developing countries, emit less. Others, mostly developed countries, emit more. In our view, a country has to reduce its emissions within a year, as we explain in the commentary to the Enterprises Principle, to the permissible quantum. Well, we have discussed at quite some length how to deal with the reduction obligation of enterprises. And there is no obvious answer to that question. We realize that. It would have been possible to submit a formula with a great many factors that have to be taken into account. Well, perhaps that would have been, seen from a strictly legal angle, a better solution, but it would be completely pointless. Such a formula can't be applied. Nobody has a clue how to balance the various factors. So that was, in our view, not a brilliant idea. And we couldn't think of anything better than an enterprise, at least as a rule of thumb, an enterprise has to reduce its emissions at the same rate as the country in which it is based. That means that Bayer Germany has to reduce its emissions at the same rate as Germany, and General Motors US at the same rate as the US. That's only different if a country without obligations according to the Oslo principles has pledged to reduce its emissions under the Paris Agreement. Well, in such a scenario, it makes sense that also enterprises in those countries have to reduce their emissions at the same rate. And then, for your purpose, an important topic, and that's also something we really have discussed at length. How to attribute emissions. In our view, you have to count the emissions caused by a specific enterprise, and not the emissions caused by the products or services put on the market by the enterprise. That means, in relation to big oil, that we don't agree with an emerging view that big oil is the one and only problem. We don't think that that's right. And there are many reasons for that view. First, it's a very unattractive view because it would mean that all others would argue, well, we don't have obligations. No, big oil has, and they have to solve the problem. Not the slightest chance that we can solve the problem. Secondly, as a matter of fact, regrettably so, but still, our world still needs oil and gas. Yeah, that's really regrettable. And the sooner we can get rid of the demand, the better. No doubt about that. But for the time being, we need it. And it would be a bit strange to tell them, well, you're no longer allowed to put on the market what we need because we are unwilling to curb our emissions to the extent needed. Also, we doubt whether there would be a sound legal basis for the submission that the emissions caused by products and services put on the market by an enterprise have to be attributed to the manufacturer. Now, you could argue that way, but we don't think that that is a very sound argument. Also, the calculation would be very difficult. How to calculate the emissions further down the chain? And last but not least, if it would be true that only big oil would have reduction obligations, enforcement will be very difficult, to say the very least. How to enforce the obligation of, say, Gazprom won't be easy. Back to the idea that as a rule of thumb, enterprises have to align with the reduction obligations of the country in point. Well, we realize that you can't lump all enterprises together. We realized that some already did a lot, others didn't do anything at all, and there is a lot in between. Some are based on the most recent techniques, others are not. We know that. As we realize that it may be fair to distinguish between those enterprises. But in our view, if we couldn't think of anything better again, we have to leave the two countries. And then you have again to make a difference between countries complying with their own obligations and countries that don't. Obviously, countries that comply with their own obligations have more maneuvering room than countries that don't comply with their obligations. If a country does comply with its own reduction obligations, and for clarity's sake, that means mostly more than their pledges under the Paris Agreement, because they are hugely insufficient, then it has the right to strike a different balance and to be more lenient to some and more demanding to other enterprises. And if a country does not comply, it has the same possibility, but all enterprises together should at least reduce their emissions at the rate necessary. And in deviating from the key rule, they have to take a series of factors into account mentioned in Article Principle 3.1. Then we have a principle about what we have labeled global enterprises. In our view, it does not make much sense to lump together a domestic enterprise in a developing country and an enterprise which is a subsidiary of a multinational based in, say, the Netherlands or Germany or the United States. We have developed a formula, and that formula is not perfect. We are very open about that in the commentary. There are always borderline cases, and in those cases you have to use common sense. But as a rule of thumb, we believe that subsidiaries belonging to a group of enterprises with their seat in a country that emits more than the permissible quantum has to reduce its emissions in below permissible quantum countries at the rate of the world at large. That means that a subsidiary of, General Motors in Nigeria has to emit its emissions at the rate of the world at large. Well, Nigeria clearly is a country that emits less than permissible. If you would apply our core rule, the subsidiary would have no reduction obligations, but we believe that would be unfair. In line with the Oslo principles, we believe that it is utterly reasonable that enterprises reduce their emissions if that can be achieved at no or very little cost. In our view, that speaks for itself. And for example, that means that if an enterprise can choose between an energy supplier that provides energy based on fossil fuels and energy based on renewables, and the price is the same, they have to opt for the supplier that provides energy based on renewable energy. We also believe that it is, as a rule of thumb, fair to require that an enterprise incurs costs that will pay back. If, for example, it would be possible to install solar equipment, and by doing so, in a couple of years, the investment would pay back, as a rule of thumb, it seems utterly reasonable to require such an investment. Of course, there are, again, difficult cases. For example, an enterprise has to make a choice between an acquisition or installing solar equipment? Well, there is no hard and fast rule to answer that question. Another example, well, if a subsidiary of a multinational which has to reduce its emissions at the rate of the world at large could reduce its emissions further by an investment that would pay back, but would have the choice between higher wages and paying such an investment. Well, then we don't dare to say that the enterprise is not allowed to pay the higher wages. Well, there are more borderline cases, but the principle as such makes sense in our view. We also believe that enterprises should refrain from activities or putting products and services on the market that emit excessive amounts of greenhouse gases. Well, you can debate at length what excessive means, and probably as time progresses, the yardstick will become stricter and stricter. One of the solutions is, well, you can look at competitors. And if they emit significantly less, well, that is at least a reason to believe that the emissions of a significantly higher emitting product, service, or activity is excessive. And then the enterprise has a choice, either to phase out the products, services, or activities, or to take countervailing measures. That will mean that that there is no longer a market for some products and services. That has always been the case. Asbestos is the perfect example. In our view, an enterprise has to consider the emissions of its suppliers. Well, to consider means more than ticking the box, so much is clear. For the remainder, it is a bit vague, and for the time being, we think unavoidably vague. And my personal guess is that over time, we can and have to become more demanding. In our view, according to the commentary, the mere fact that a product provided by a specific supplier is cheaper than the product of its competitors is not necessarily a justification. We have a series of principles about scenarios an enterprise can't comply with our principles. Happy to go into detail, but for the sake of time, I could imagine that you prefer me to refer to the commentary. I'm talking about principle 12 and 13 and 16. These exceptions are strict, but they are deliberately strict. We are very keen to avoid all kinds of excuses. That will be way too easy. It will be very easy for enterprises to think of reasons why they can't comply. And, well, some of those reasons may make sense. Many are understandable that they make the point. But if we would go along with that kind of arguments, we can't solve the problem. So we really have to be strict. And then a brain teaser, minimal causation. In our view, minimal causation is not a defense. Doesn't speak for itself. We know that. Some academics strike a parallel with asbestos. Personally, I strongly believe that the parallel doesn't make sense. Why not? Well, if you look at the portion manufacturers or employers active in the asbestos area, caused the problem, and you compare that with the contribution of single enterprises to the global problem, well, I can't avoid saying that the contribution in relation to the global climate change problem is not negligible in relation to the causation caused by individual enterprises in relation to asbestos. Still, we strongly believe minimal causation is not a defense. And, perhaps surprisingly, but still, that view is, in our view, endorsed by the US Supreme Court, Massachusetts versus EPA. It is endorsed recently in the Uganda judgment. True, the Uganda judgment is about an obligation of the state and not an obligation of enterprise. And that's different. I realize that. But the argument is, to put it very briefly, it can't be true that the law has nothing to offer in relation to climate change. And that's my own addition, that would mean the law is only about nitty-gritty. That is a very unsatisfactory view, and we don't think that that is true. And then, and that's controversial. We know that, and we don't hide it. In our view, enterprises and states can't argue, well, but if we look at domestic or international law, we are not under an obligation to reduce our emissions at a higher rate. So why should we? We are saying, and that is slightly overstating our case, we know that we are open about it, we are saying that if our principles are more demanding than what domestic or international law requires, enterprises have to comply with the principles. That, of course, is too general. That's not entirely true. What we mean is enterprises have to reduce their emissions at the rate necessary. And that almost certainly it is more than what domestic and international law currently requires, at least more than the Paris Agreement. Well, if countries would comply with the Paris Agreement, we will end up somewhere between 2.7 and 3.6 degrees. Hence, much more must be done. That's clear. So, states and enterprises can't decently argue, in our view, well, but that's all we have to do. We don't think so. And then we have a series of principles about disclosures. And when I started working on this project, my personal view was, well, that matters, of course, but that's not overly important. And the more I think and the more I read about it, the more I believe disclosure obligations are very important. Why? Well, they will bring business leaders to their senses. If they have to figure out the consequences of climate change for their enterprises, they will understand that they must do much more than most of them currently do. And it makes it much easier also for investors to assess whether enterprises do a good job and